to be part of the MicroFest cycle work. And so for each of the four communities that we're in, Detroit, Appalachia, New Orleans, Hawaii, we invited people, artists, people working cross-sector in those communities to apply for these fellowships. And we have eight amazing fellows that have been to all of these events, and they've been, their task over the course of the MicroFest is to look at how, just kind of look inquisitively, look, taking close examinations at how art and or how communities in distress, in economic, environmental, other forms of stress and distress, are using art as a way of addressing these challenges, these needs. And that's been kind of a guiding question for the cohort. And at each of these meetings, we meet before the MicroFest and we talk about what we're seeing, what we're thinking, what we observe, what's happening in their own communities. And then afterwards, we can pull together and we can do a little debrief, look ahead a little bit. And so now as we're more than halfway through the MicroFest cycle, we thought this would be a really good opportunity to just invite them to make some space in the schedule to hear their thoughts. As your peers, our peers, people who are asking similar questions, doing similar work, the practitioners that come from different backgrounds, but it's the opportunity to just check in with some of the learning that's been happening overall. And part of this is also we're now kind of more than halfway through this event, and as the as we move forward, we're going to start to zoom out a little bit more. So you know, yesterday, earlier this morning, we're looking closely at what's happening here on the ground. There's been some national voices, but now, you know, as we kind of reach the end of this event, we're going to start to pull out a little bit. And as we think about what's going to happen in Honolulu in June, this becomes a nice little segue also just to give a little check-in with the cycle so far, and also with kind of starting to plant some ideas and connect some dots as we move forward. So at this point, I'm going to hand it over to our cohorts. They will introduce themselves, introduce the session, and here you go. Welcome.
Hello and welcome. To me, it feels like it's more of a taking a breath, because so much is thrown at you, and I think like a little pause. If this is a roller coaster ride, yeah, this is where we're stopping. Before we go up the next big thing, you can adjust your seatbelt and talk to your neighbor and talk about it. I feel like it's a time to just reflect a little bit and process, but we don't want to pile more stuff on you. We want to make it easier.
So we got together as a cohort and just thought what would work for us in terms of trying to, as Ricardo Levins Morales put forth in a cultural organizing workshop, prepare the landscape, prepare the ground, appropriate fertilization, so that when the fruit comes to bear, it's what we want and it's sustainable. And knowing that we're all, speaking from my standpoint, you know, I'm here in the middle of an incredible amount of stimulation that's happening all the time. And so I'm having these connections in the moment. And in order to be present in the moment, I don't want to think about, you know, what I'm going to do next or what I'm going to do beyond here. But I think that's what we're going to start to try to prepare in the soil is, you know, in making these connections here, how do we start turning our attention forward so that we don't just get on whatever transportation back to our homes tomorrow and say, okay, now what? I'm exhausted. But we start filtering that into the space. We start broadening out our capacity. And so we want to offer a way to introduce ourselves that will translate into everyone being able to introduce themselves in smaller groups that hopefully will start to seed that conversation, fertilize that conversation towards not just these connections here, but so we can easily transition into how it affects our work moving forward. So we're going to model that here.
So I think each of the cohort is going to give a little example and present a question, and then we're going to open it up and break it down into groups. So we'll go ahead with each cohort.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
What's up, Moose? Bringing you that moose juice? Inside, yo.
It's not that inside.
All right. Okay, my name is Trepanya Trap Island, and I'm a native of Central City, New Orleans. Some people call it the mouth, some say the third world, but it's called Central City these days. I'm a filmmaker, and how this MicroFest has impacted my work, it's immediate, because yesterday I was allowed to share some of my work with members of the NetFest, which I thought was really grand. My PTS went up, but some other folks got to feel a little bit of that and understand how this city's been reshaped since the unnatural disaster of Katrina. And so my question is, how will this experience enhance and add on to my work? That's my question.
Hi everybody, Lisa Webnos. I am native of Detroit, Michigan. Third generation Mexican American. My great grandparents came to Detroit to work for Ford Motor Company. And when they came to Ford Motor Company, they had very hard jobs. After I went to art school, I ended up being a corporate photographer at Ford Motor Company for 22 years until the market went down in 2008 and closed my department. So since then, I've been doing freelance work, and I've been doing a lot of community projects with youth. I've done the diversity photography program. I created some public art. I did this beautiful mural in Southwest Detroit with Cecil Chavez. So that's why I'm finding it really exciting to look around these other communities and see what's going on here and see what I can take back to my community. Southwest Detroit has the largest population of Latinos in the city, and it's also the most diverse section of Detroit. So I'm excited to look at what everybody else has and also get feedback from other people on how things work in their cities. But I'm also interested in finding out for me personally is, how do I measure the value of the work that I do? What is the value of having a mural of Chavez in my neighborhood? So I'm hoping that I'll figure that out.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are you? My name is Jessica Brooke Williams. I am born and raised in Detroit, Michigan, and one of the fellows for this fellowship. I wanted to basically give you guys an idea of who I am, and just for the record, I do not ID at all as a theater maker or an artist, but I do identify as one historian of the African diaspora and of modern American art. I ID as a campaign fundraiser, where I have had the job of raising over $1 million within 1 year with our corporate partners for our initiatives at United Way. I identify as a foundation representative. I actually have worked in a foundation for the last 2 years of my life on the investment side, where I'm looking at the money, making money to then give to arts organizations and grantees who do what it is they need to do in the community. And then I moved into a role on the programmatic side of the foundation to see how can a foundation create initiatives to use its money the best way? How do they engage more residents? How do they do it in a proper way? And that's new to me for the last week of my life. and then I also identify as an evaluator. I have worked for the last 6 months. Yes, three jobs, almost in common. I work as an evaluator for a research firm that looks at nonprofit organizations and their programs and tries to analyze the data on them and give them better ways to, you know, operate their organization, how they can roll out their programs. And then lastly, I identify as a cultivator of the arts. For the last 5 years, I've worked with young adults who have ideas about what they want to do with their art, but they don't know how to connect. They don't know how to connect with the United Way or a foundation or an evaluation firm to help them understand how to collect the data of their program and make it measurable. So in all those weird ideas that I have about myself, I sort of have an ensemble in my mind of all these different languages I have to speak when I'm in one place or within another, in the foundation world or in the campaign fundraising world. It's very ensemble-ish. So I basically, through these MicroFests, have had this leverage my curiosity to look more at the legislative standpoint of engaging arts and developing communities and all that. So maybe that'll be a sixth sense that I gained. And my question was, how can philanthropic efforts leverage language development to better communicate the impact of the arts in sustaining thriving communities? So that's my question that hopefully will inspire you guys to ask a question about how this can leverage your work. How can philanthropic efforts leverage language development to better communicate the impact of the arts and sustain thriving communities? That's my question.
Hi, everybody. My name is Nakia Mary Harrison, or Nikki, just chop off the YA. So I'm from Knoxville, Tennessee. Well, no, I'm living in Knoxville, Tennessee. I'm from Chicago. And so I guess when you interact with me, knowing this kind of struggle of place where I'm at and where I'm from, and the values of what I brought with me and the values of where I'm at now. My identifier to the first is a social worker, macro level social worker that works with communities and organizations and systems. Next, it would be a community organizer. So I have academic foundations from the University of Tennessee. Go Vols. No. But the other part of my education, which is very significant to me, is through Highland Research and Education Center. And that's where I learned, okay, so Highland, not the law. But that brings my grounding of the use of popular education, participatory research, and including everybody and recognizing everyone as experts in their own environment and not their own experiences. So very much taking away that hierarchy and that power that's so present in how we deal with everyday life. The impact that MicroFest or the MicroFest have had on me is really, I'm still struggling with it as far as how to really make it a tangible thing. But the main thing is seeing the potential for really, like, really making some powerful work happen and to see the power of collaboration. So this whole issue of cross-sector collaboration is like, I'm sorry, I'm beginning to look at y'all. it's more powerful than I think we realized just yet, you know? And I really am interested and energized by moving that work forward. And so my question is simple. It's how do we make art more accessible or relevant for common folk?
Aloha y kakou. Respond with aloha to and aloha. I'm Moses, obviously I'm from Hawaii. What I identify with is I am an actor. I've been a working actor for about a decade now. About a decade. That's no easy thing in Hawaii. However, about a year ago, I made the decision to leave my job with the theater company that I was with for about 3 years. To work at the Bishop Museum. For those of you who don't know, it's kind of the museum of the Pacific in terms of culture, not just Hawaiian culture, the culture of all throughout the different cultures of the Pacific.
So I made that decision to switch from being an actor there, working at the museum, for personal reasons, also for financial reasons as well, because being a working actor doesn't pay all the bills, but also for Kuliana, and for those of you who remember from Appalachia, what Kuliana is, that's a responsibility, a life's responsibility in a nutshell. So I made that decision and I did it. However, I then became a cultural educator. But most of you, the people that have talked to me, ask me what I do, and I say I'm a storyteller. I say storyteller because it is part of what I do as a cultural educator, but at the same time, it's not all of what I do, but I say storyteller because it's my way of still identifying with being an actor of some sort, with being an artist of some sort, because I wasn't ready to embrace my identity as an educator. So that's something that I started to kind of, I guess, struggle with about a year ago. A half a year ago, someone gave me this application and said, apply for the MicroFest. I really had no idea what it was. I went on a trip to the Solomon Islands for a few weeks and came back and the application was due that night. So I'm like, I'm not going to do it. And then it's 12 o'clock and I'll do it. And so I started typing, and I finished it around 2:30 and I sent it in and I said, okay, whatever happens, happens. And then I got it. A few weeks later, I got it. And then a few weeks after that, I'm in Detroit. And I'm like, okay, now what? I really don't know what I'm doing here, but I'm along for the ride. So I get here, I get to Detroit, and I'm surrounded immediately by amazing people that know exactly who they are, where they are, and all of that. And I was at a point where I didn't quite know where I was, what I fully identified with. And on top of me finding these new things that I am, I'm now an educator, I also find out at MicroFest that I'm an advocate, and that I'm an activist, and all of these different things, which is super exciting and amazing that I can explore these new worlds, but also very daunting, because now I'm an actor. That's all I want to be, that's all I've ever wanted to be, and I was that, and now I have to wear all these different hats, which are amazing, and I can affect a lot of people and a lot of lives this way, but how do I do that? Okay, almost done. And then right before this trip, right, like the day I got on the plane to come here to New Orleans, someone came back from another conference in my office, in our cultural education office, saying how at that conference, it's a writing conference you went to, they were like, you know what, you are either an educator or you're an artist, pick one or the other. And so that, and I know we don't all agree with that, but that's what she came back with. And that, what that said to me, I can't forget what I am at the core of everything. I am an actor. However, I do embrace that I am these other things. So what MicroFest means to me is it's trying to find a way to embrace these new hats that I'm wearing, but still stay true to who I am. And I guess that's my question as well, as I try to wrap it up really quickly. But that's my two cents for this. Thanks.
Good afternoon. I'm Will Bowling, and I've had a very long and inspirational morning. I am a non-native New Orleanian. In fact, I identify as a post-K, white, Midwestern, middle-class artist transplant, which comes with its sort of own baggage. I'm also an ensemble theater artist, an arts educator, and an arts administrator, not necessarily in that order, but I run the New Orleans-based Goat in the Road Ensemble as the co-artistic director. I teach for them, and I also work for the National Performance Network, which is also based in New Orleans. This has been a really amazing experience, and I'm really honored that NET's given me this opportunity, so thank you, Mark, and all of NET for that. Some of the things that these last conferences have gotten me thinking about. When we went to Detroit, my immediate correlations are to New Orleans. I'm looking at a place that has suffered a displacement of people, a diaspora of some sort, whether that's in the wake of economic devastation or environmental devastation, infrastructural, et cetera. and how in the wake of that you see these influxes of artist outsider, artist transplant, creative class to sort of bring the Richard Florida into it. And then you see this creative placemaking happening and how while there's a certain inevitability to that, there's also a huge problem to it. And there's ups and there's downs, there's goods, there's bads. And trying to sort of unpack that all in relation to my own identifier as a as an artist living and working here who's not from here. And I see some of that happening in Detroit too. And so that opportunity immediately brought those questions into play for me. Then I moved to Appalachia and I'm struck with this idea of ensemble practice and how it's working in an activist mentality to help support environmental justice concerning coal mining, mountaintop removal, etc. And how some of the tenets of ensemble practices we identify collaboration, transparency, flux, lateral organizational movement, you know, a decentralization of authorship or curatorial authority, and how some of those come into play in activist practice as well. And whether or not we can consider ensemble practice as inherently activist or, and I know that's a broad brushstroke, the opposite of that being, is activist practice inherently ensembled? This got me thinking about that. I think the question that I want to ask though is as an artist, I spent a lot of time thinking about ensemble practice and those values that we correlate with them. Again, collaboration, transparency, flux, lateral organizational structure, that sort of decentralization of authorship, and how we use those cross-sector and how we can apply those cross-sector to the work that, that everyone in this room is doing. And we spend a lot of time talking about that. We don't, I feel, spend a lot of time talking about some of the ways that ensemble practices don't work or that they not fail, but they are difficult. We all know that ensemble creative process is incredibly difficult. And sometimes it works beautifully and sometimes it doesn't. And a recognition of when it doesn't and why it doesn't, and how we can take those conversations into the cross-sector work. So.
Hey y'all.
Hey.
I'm Bob Martin. I'm from Kentucky. I live in a place called Clear Creek. Honored to be here with some of my Kentucky family. I identify as a teaching artist, as a theater maker, as a storyteller, as a cultural organizer, and as someone who is on some sort of path of healing through this work with myself and with community. Amazing opportunity for connectivity because you all are a fantastic, dynamic group of folks. So, as I was talking with Jerry Stropnicki earlier, I don't feel as isolated as I sometimes feel in trying to pull together a lot of different shreds and strains of work to make a living and to make a change and to heal myself and my community. So that connectivity, I think, is worth it just alone. But then I think beyond that, being able to look at some of these important things that are drawn out in terms of how do we work together in these cross-sector places. So we're not just in a theater or in a school or in a legislative position, but we're filtering through all of those places through our civic participation with grace and with awareness of where we come from and with the ability to creatively vision where we would like to go next in creating healthy communities for ourselves and for our families. So we are asking questions. One question is someone who doesn't have a lot of experience working in ensemble, but who deeply believes in collaboration is, how can I, with my community of storytellers of all different stripes, use ensemble as a unifying force in bringing all of our stories together and make positive change in our community and out into the world? Thank you.
Okay, I'm the last cohort to go before we break up. My name is Lisa Shattuck. I'm from here, born in Mercy Hospital. I am a theater maker, an educator, a mother. I'm an ensemble member of Art Spot Productions. I'm also a proud cohort, and one of the things we get to do as a cohort is we write reflections after each MicroFest. So I have a 30-second excerpt from two of my reflections, one from the Kentucky-Tennessee MicroFest and one from the Detroit. Very short that I'd like to read because I think it will answer the questions. Okay, this one's from the Kentucky-Tennessee MicroFest. I couldn't see the mountain because it had been removed. Even if it would have been the clearest sky sunshine day and I looked as far as I could see from the top of Black Mountain, the tallest in Kentucky, I couldn't have seen it. The mountain had been removed by surface coal mining in a process in which coal companies deforest the peak and extract the coal with explosives to leave a flattened version of the landscape. When I stood on this unsettled ground of sharp gray rocks in Harlan County, Kentucky, it felt similar to standing on the slab of my childhood home near New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. I felt powerless. I had never seen this mountain, nor the culture that it nurtured, but my heart mourned instinctively. I tried to see the mountain with my ears, so I stood still to listen. And from the Detroit MicroFest, 30 seconds of my reflection. Although I'm proud to be a net MicroFest fellow, I felt my privilege and responsibility smothering me during the Detroit MicroFest in August. I felt discomfort in behaving like an art scientist, observing the art and cultural expressions of a city under distress and responding with questions such as, what can we learn and how do we connect? From the first panel titled Art, the Avant-Garde, and the Realities of Resurrecting an American City, there was tension. I sensed the revolutionaries in the room. They asked important questions about racism and trying to fight those who do not understand your culture, Detroit property taxes, and if the murals on the vacant buildings aren't as beautiful for those who just need a place to live. This tension resurfaced in every event I attended, pushing me to think outside my own city and outside my art-making skills. I was tasked to think about and talk about what art does instead of just making it. The MicroFest are an ambitious undertaking bringing together art makers and non-art sector leaders from all over the country looking at how art making strengthens neighborhoods. I was honored to meet Detroiters working hard to develop their community. They reminded me of warriors in the midst of a long battle inspired by even respite. I left Detroit melancholy with unanswered questions. So today, the question I have here in New Orleans is a personal one. How can I expand my relationship as an artist to my community?
So real quick, before we break off, until everyone has their cards, so you know which group you're in, how many people in Group 8? Group 8? Group 8? Okay, you're rolling with trap. All right, before we break off into circles, we just want to go over a few community agreements. And I want you to remember two words. One word, respect. The other word, oppression. All right? We're going to respect each other's opinions, and we're going to create an oppression-free zone. All right? Does anyone know what that means? You don't? Oh, I guess I should tell you. Many of us are familiar with what oppression feels like. We're not always familiar with what it looks like, okay? And so when we break off into these circles, we're going to be sharing a series of questions with one another, and everyone's question is their own unique perspective, right? And we're going to choose one question, and then we're going to share a conversation with one another, right? So as someone begins to share their opinion, other folks may feel contrary to their opinion, and we're asking you to hold it in, walk out of the space and scream yell as loud as you can yell outside of the space, right? So we want you to deal with your personal feelings outside of the space so that we can get through this exercise, right? We do not want to create an oppressive zone. You want to add anything to that? Cool. Okay. Right, we're good with that. We can go over to the description of the circles.
Okay, so I'm one of those people who are always on the 5 to 10 second delay because my brain is like, let me make sure I get it. So I'm giving y'all instructions so that you get what we're doing. You guys have heard, you've had a chance to hear kind of our experiences and the questions that we've come up with in our own mind. And, you know, I want to bring this back to the theme to just kind of bring to your forefront. It's like, what does this have to do with me and my work, right? And so we want to give all of you an opportunity to respond, but although we can't do it in a big circle. So we are going to break up into 8 groups. Each of you have a note card with a number on it. It corresponds to the note card that one of the cohorts had. When you break up into your groups, which you'll follow whoever has your number, and each person in the circle is going to go around and ask a question similar to the way we ask our question. And really, we're trying to figure out, giving you an opportunity. This is about you participants. So we want to give you time to ask questions. We will go around and give everyone a chance to ask their question. And then after we do that, us as a smaller group will answer those questions amongst ourselves. And then after we have some time to do that, we'll come back to the larger group and do report backs on what you and your group discussed. We are not having like an official reporter email. This is organic. And so when you do report back, we want someone to report back from their personal experience, right? Not necessarily speaking for the group or about the group, but bringing it back to you, because this is really time that we wanted you guys to reflect and keep reflecting on what this means to you and your work, okay? So I guess all the ones, if you have a one on your note card, you're what quality be, all right? We're not gonna move yet, just letting you know who your leader is. If you have a 2 on your note card, you're with Lisa. If you have a 3, you're with Jessica Brooke Williams. If you have a 4, you're with Lisa, the other Lisa.
Lisa L.
If you have a 5, you're with Moses Goods, and he has some goods, I think. If you have a 6, you're with me. Okay. If you have a 7, you're with Will. And if you have an 8, you're with Pat. So what we're going to do is, you're a leader, we're kind of position ourselves in the part of the room that you'll be in. And if you could kind of loop your chairs into a sit of a smaller circle, be respectful of the beautiful floor. So kind of pick up your chair instead of dragging it. Okay? So we'll take a minute, 60 seconds, for you to find your leader and to get into smaller circles.